up and speak his word. Rise up to what you've heard. Rise up this very hour. Rise up with Jesus Christ. Rise up in Jesus' name. Open eyes and heal the lame. Rise up, declare his truth. We're the ones who cannot lose.
And rise, we've got to rise. Satan's head, it's time to rise up.
Amen. God's word is true, and when you stand on it, it stands with you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, this morning, and I don't know, actually it was some time ago, I taught a lesson called The Promise, the Power, and the Proof, talking about the Holy Spirit. Well, this morning we're going to pick that up. Now, I know that was actually some time back, but this is going to be kind of a part two to that. So if you haven't heard that one, I believe it's in the bookstore, so you could pick one of those up on your way out and put these two together and listen to them, because I get questions all the time about, well, it's funny because Marty, y'all know Marty from Canada, Marty and Bridget, they're our Canadian J.G. Lim representatives. And it's funny because Marty, he's been with me all over the world. He's been with me in pretty much as I've taught each different seminar and different topics. And he said, you know, it's funny, Craig, if you were teaching a course in algebra, you'd get questions on healing. And that's just the way it is. So no matter what we teach, we get questions on healing. Well, another of the main questions that we get, actually there's several different categories, but another main question is the difference. A lot of them have to do with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And some of the main questions have to do with what is the difference between the real baptism of the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues? Well, I don't know where that kind of came from because there's not really a difference in there, right? However, there is information there. But then we get into other things like practices. And see, practices are individual things that take place, sometimes through wrong teaching, sometimes through experience, which can sometimes be according to wrong teaching. But many times a person will do something, a minister or just a Christian, let's just say a Christian, and hopefully the minister is a Christian. Hopefully it works out that way. But they would do something a certain way, and it worked. And sometimes after they've done other things that didn't work, then they did this, and it worked, and all of a sudden they make that into a doctrine. One of those things is what we saw when we went out to North Carolina. Now, this takes other places, or happens other places too, but when we were in South Carolina, or North Carolina, whenever I went to cast the devil out of a person, invariably they would start coughing. And you could tell it wasn't just happening, they were making it happen. In other words, they were kind of, I mean, you can tell when a person's coughing to want to cough. You know what I'm saying? There's a cough that happens that you can't really help, and then there's a cough that you do. And that was the cough they were doing. Every time I would start to cast out a devil, they would and I'm like, what is... Everybody's doing that. Why is everybody doing that? Well, come to find out, they had come from a particular ministry that said that when you cast out a devil, that's how it leaves. Is that you'll cough or there'll be something like that, and that's what they did. So, and that. But the sad part is that became a doctrine. Now, the first time they did it, and even other times, it probably worked. I mean, it probably, that's what happened, and they noticed it, but then they made it a doctrine, and then people started doing it. Well, the bad part about that is then you can't tell if the thing's really being coming out, or if they're doing that. Well, you can tell because they're fake coughing. So, you know, I have a basic philosophy. If it's God, it works. And if it's God, it's real. And if it's not real, you don't want it. Amen? Isn't that true? I mean, it's just, you know, I don't like the idea of playing church. and playing church means you just follow the rules. You go along and you find a group that kind of matches what you believe and you just kind of fit in with them. And then everybody, you know, to me, it's the old story. Remember the fable, I guess, of the emperor's new clothes? That's kind of the way a lot of church is. And I don't like that. To me, if it's Bible, if it's God's word, it will work. And so let's get back to doing that. And if we do that, then God can work. Now, one of the problems is if you do something that then it works, and then, like I said, you can make a doctrine out of it or you can have an experience, then you can do the same thing. Now, I want to preface this, and so you kind of have to follow along here. There is an aspect of you setting your faith for a certain thing, just like the woman with the issue of blood. She said within herself, if I just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. She set her faith, and then she did that thing. And when she did, she got healed. So there is an aspect of you setting your faith. And I know people come here a lot of times, and I say, well, you know, I've been to the doctor, been to this person prayed for me, but if I can get there and Brother Curry lays hands on me, I'll get healed. And many times, you get healed on your own faith just because of that. Now, I'm applying my faith, but many times people get healed of their own faith because they set their faith that whenever I touch them, they're going to get healed. So even if I didn't set my faith to do it, they'd still get healed. Why? Because they set their faith, right? Now let's take it kind of the other end of the spectrum. There is this thing that we know to be true to a degree called the placebo effect, which placebo effect is not a good thing to rely on, all right? And the problem is, when you know about it, it tends to stop working for you. So, you know, it's kind of, do we tell them? We not tell them. So what I want to talk about this morning is a little bit, I'm going to bring all these things in. What I'm against is priming the pump. You know what I mean by priming the pump? That's people say, okay, you want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to lay hands or whatever. And then they say, okay, now just begin making sounds. And the people, they don't know what to do. And then usually that person starts praying in tongues, the person ministering. And then they just imitate. And it's not even real baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's just them imitating sounds. And they say, well, we're priming the pump so that you remember in the old day, maybe you don't remember, I don't remember it either. I'm not that old. I don't remember that. I've seen them in antique stores, okay? I didn't grow up with them. I didn't grow up on a farm or anything. But, you know, you had these pumps, and the first few times you would pump it, nothing would happen because it had to prime the pump. And many times they had to actually take some water. They would keep a little bucket of water, and they would pour that in there first, and that's called priming the pump. And then they would pump, and then water would come out. So that's what a lot of people do with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They want to prime the pump. So they just say, and you know the old joke, repeat after me, and they would start saying, you know, tie my bow tie, tie my bow. Remember, if you were in the 70s, the charismatic area, you remember that time, okay? People did that stuff. And so I've never agreed with it. I've never liked it. And so that's why many times when we minister to people, I went back to the Bible, and it said that when people, now obviously in Acts chapter 1, chapter 2, people received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and we're going to talk about that. But then later on in Acts, it actually says that the apostles, when they found people that were believers but had not received the baptism of the Spirit, then they would say that the apostles would lay hands upon them and say, receive the Holy Ghost, and they would be filled. So that's what we tend to do. And so what I do is whenever people say, I want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, then usually I lay hands on them and I say, receive the Holy Spirit. And then from there on, I have nothing to do with it. Then it's between them and God. Does that make sense? Because I don't want to get into the priming the thing and the doing the step. Why? Because I would rather you leave here without any experience and continue telling God, I want to receive. I want it. I've got it. I believe. And so I want to experience all you've got. Rather than you leaving with a false sense of having attained something that you don't have. And many people have done that, and they say, well, I've spoken in tongues. Maybe, maybe not. Maybe what you did wasn't speaking in tongues. Maybe it was making sounds, which, again, I believe, and I was with Dr. Summerall, and he used to talk about this, And there are people that had not received the baptism of the Spirit, but they would actually make sounds. And he said, God can use that as prayer, because he can take the sound, your faith, and he can take that sound. And he said, he can say, today these sounds mean this, and he can apply it towards something. Now, you know, I'd never heard that before. And okay, I can agree with that. God can take, if he can make everything out of nothing, he can take something and make something else out of it. That's just the way I feel about it. So, but then many people have been seeking the Holy Spirit or the infilling of the Holy Spirit for a long time. Now, back in the early days of Pentecost, early 1900s, people, they used to do what they called tarrying meetings. And they would tarry for the Holy Spirit based on Luke 24, Acts 1, kind of putting those two in a time gap there, that he said, wait, tarry ye in Jerusalem until you receive the promise of the Father. And so many times people would tarry, they would wait, and they would have tarrying meetings where they all came together on a specific night on purpose, sometimes after church, sometimes other nights, and they would just gather around the altar, and they were all seeking the baptism or infilling of the Holy Spirit. And during that time, many of them would receive, but others wouldn't. And sometimes, well, like John Lake heard about the baptism of the Spirit from the Pentecostal outpouring early in 1907, and then by October, roughly October of 1907, he finally received. And he said it took him 9 months to receive the baptism of the Spirit. So that was a common thing. Now, again, experiences sometimes become doctrines. And people would start tarrying. And then they would come down to the front, every altar, every service, they would come down to the altar, and they would start begging God, God, fill me with the Holy Spirit. God, give me your Holy Spirit. And then you would have some well-meaning but wrong Christian tended to be a busybody, okay? That was the person that usually did. And they would wander among the people that were seeking, and they would look for something. And many times when they come forward, the women would come forward, and they would have jewelry on or something, and this well-meaning but wrong person would say, well, if you'd take that jewelry off, God will baptize you in his Holy Ghost, because the Bible says don't have any ornamentation except, you know, holiness. And they would start saying these things, right? Now, that's when the placebo effect would kick in, because they would take it off thinking, okay, now he's going to fill me. Boom. And their faith would rise and they would get filled. And so that experience became a doctrine. So hopefully you can see how all this is working together. Now, nowadays we have new doctrines, new sacred cows, dealing with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Probably the number one question I get now has to do with this, and I actually wrote it down, is that people ask about what some churches / ministries, whatever, you know, you want to call them, do concerning the baptism of the Spirit. And because many people, believe they have received the baptism of the Spirit, but then they recognize they're still lacking something. And so then they start seeking a second baptism. And they call that the baptism of fire. And then they have their fire tunnels where they gather on each side and people go through and they get blessed and whatever else. And they, you know, a bunch of things start happening, many of which have no scriptural basis. But at the same time, they come out the other end and they come out blessed or whatever it is. Now, many times when we say blessing, it's not a real blessing. It's just soulishly, they feel they had a good time. They had a good experience. Okay, that's not a blessing, right? A blessing is when God actively imparts something into your life and you leave differently than you came. Do you see that, right? Now, but we have these people now that are practicing, and for instance, I'll give you another experience that becomes doctrine. This idea of going into the courts of heaven. Say Robert Henderson, if you know who that is, he's actually written several books now. And well, anyway, his finances are not our business. So, but he's written several books on this topic of going into the courts of heaven and presenting your case and all that kind of stuff. And what happened was his son had a very very big problem, and I'm not even gonna say what I think it was. I don't really remember exactly, but I'm pretty sure. But regardless, he had a big problem. And he was praying, and his dad, Robert, was praying and praying and praying, and nothing was happening. And then finally, somehow, he somehow heard something or read something about the courts of heaven. In the Bible, it talks about entering God's courts with praise and doing these things. And so he decided to do that. And when he decided to do that, he decided, here's what I'm going to do. And so he mentally decided to enter the courts of heaven, okay? And then make a decree from there that would affect earth. So anyway. And then after that, his son got free. So all of a sudden, now this is now a doctrine. Let's do this. My experience has now become a doctrine, and now he goes all over teaching everybody to do this thing, which is wasted motion. See, you don't need to do that. There's nothing about you. You're already seated in heavenly place. You don't need to go. You're seated there. Amen? Now, so we reign and rule from there, so I don't have any problem with that. But it's the idea of going there. Now, see, Billy Brim, another great woman of God, did kind of the same thing in her teaching on authority. And in that, she talks about taking the seat, you taking your seat of authority. And she has a chair on her porch of her house where every morning she goes out with her Bible and her cup of coffee, and she sits down and she says, when I sit down, I am seated in my seat of authority. Right? And so that's a physical action. We would even call it maybe even a prophetic action that she does. And when she gets there, she gets into a mindset that says, okay, here's where I'm going to reign and rule from my seat of authority. Well, I can tell you, the chair on her back porch is not her seat of authority. Her seat of authority is sitting at the right hand of the Father in Christ. Amen? I get it. I understand. But I don't know what it is. I don't know why it irks me. Okay? But anything that adds unnecessary motion or unnecessary actions, because to me, and I'm sure this would not be her, all right? But to me, if you have that, then when you're not in that, you're not in your seat of authority.
Right.
And there has to be that mental thing in your mind of, I'm not seated in my seat of authority. And when you go there, you get in that seat. Now, the reason I know this is true is because when I was in the military, when I would get up in the morning, we had our beds, we had our lockers, and I had to go over and I would put on the uniform. And something happened when I put that uniform on. Something happened to me. It was early, and I might have been stumbling over there, you know, just half awake. But when I put that uniform on, I stood straight. I became clear-minded. I knew my job. I knew what I was supposed to be doing because I then represented the United States Air Force, right? So there is a mindset that can come with certain actions that you do. Now, these can also be acts of faith, you know, all kinds of different things that you can do, and there's all kinds of things you can do. Now, but the key is this. Faith happens in the Spirit. You can show faith by your actions, and your faith has to have expression. But when you make the expression the point at which your faith works, then you have made that thing more important than the faith. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So there has to be, you should be able to enter faith and exercise faith at any point without any extraneous things. That's my point. Now, when I was coming up in the 70s and 80s predominantly, everybody had their little deal of oil, you know, the little thing. And it's funny, we had these little pills, but they were big. Silver, gold colored. I'm sure some had actual gold. I don't know. And you had this thing, and you screw off the top of it, and there was oil in it. And you that was your anointing. It had a little keychain thing you put on your keychain. And, you know, if you were in the know, you could tell who was spiritual because they had their, yeah, you know, you could go to church and people made it where you could see it. Here's my oil. Okay. And so everybody had that. Well, guess what? I was young and dumb, right? And I did the same thing. I had my little bottle of oil and I would carry it around with me. And this is before I was really praying for people out in public much. I would do it at church, different things, and then started getting a hold of the DHT or at least the ideas of it and started realizing. Then one day I remember I went to Walmart and I was going to pray for a person, and I'm like, oh, I left my oil. I'll catch them next time. Do you see the problem?
Right.
And so anything that causes you to not do what the Bible says to do is wrong. Amen? And so what we have to do is we have to strip away and constantly be aware of anything that we gather, because as humans, we tend to gather experiences and we gather these mindsets that it's going to take this or it's going to take that. You know, if we can get 1,000 Christians in a city together to pray in, then we can change the city. No, it's not about 1,000. It could be one. It could be two. If any two agree. Isn't that right? So only two. So if that's, now if it's multiplication by numbers, then if you have 1,000, well, you ought to be able to change the world. I mean, exactly. Yeah, get them together and pray. But we've seen things. We've seen the call. We've seen the cry. We've seen, you know, the beg. Well, I don't think we've had a beg yet. But, well, the cry and the call, they're pretty much the beg anyway. But anyway, you have all this stuff where people think. And the bad part is that's a New Age mentality. Oh. Because what that does is, it's getting through. Okay. Amen. I mean, come on, is this true? Or can we just be honest? Because what do we have? We have these groups that get together, and they think that they're going to create this vortex over that area that's going to open heaven and let God pour down. And that's not what happens. The Bible says the heavens open to receive Christ. It never says they closed. Never says they closed. Why? Because Jesus went back, and now we have direct contact. Now, if you're right with God, the heavens never closed to you. Right? Now, if you're not right with God, then maybe the person next to you is right with God and the heavens are open just a little bit next to you. I don't know. But you know, I don't know. But whatever it is, if you want the heavens to open, just be right with God. And see, a lot of people, they when it comes to prayer, they want me to pray for them. They want me to pray for their loved ones or somebody so they will be healed. And they'll say, we even had one person, and I'm not making fun of anybody or anything else. I'm just stating some of the things. But one of them said, is it better, can you send a prayer cloth? Will that work? Or is it better to get them on the phone? You know, which prayer works better? No prayer works better than another prayer. What works is faith. And the thing is, it's not even my praying. See, many times people say, would you pray for this? And that's their way of saying they need help. And so they expect me to utter words that would pray and be prayer. And I do. I pray. If people ask me to pray, we will pray. But the key is not the prayer. It's not in the words. It's in the believing. Because see, if I pray without believing, nothing's going to happen. But if I believe, even without praying, it's still going to happen. Do you see that? So the key is believing. Just like I think I was talking about earlier last Sunday, or I think it was last Sunday, or a while back, whenever I talked about the difference between becoming and being. Well, see, prayer is kind of becoming. Believing is being. Do you get that? Because the only reason prayer works is because at some point while I'm speaking, I decide to believe this is done. If I don't believe that, I can pray all day long and nothing's going to happen. And many times, now, you can pray or say, or however you want to say it, and you can pray and pray for an hour and nothing happened. Or you can pray and believe the first second you open your mouth and it's already done. And then if you want to keep praying for an hour, glory to God, right? Sometimes you pray for an hour and you don't believe until the last minute of the hour, and that's when it's done. Sometimes you can pray yourself into believing. What are you doing? You're saying what God has said and you're getting your faith to rise up and then it hits, right? Other times you can pray yourself into unbelief. Now, and that's when you start praying wrong. Oh, God, if it's your will. Oh, God, if it's not your will. Oh, God, touch so-and-so. God, okay, God's not going to touch anybody. Do you get that? He's not going to touch anybody. He has already healed. So it's not about what he's going to do. See, that's the problem. Oh, God's going to heal me. Oh, that's a person of great faith. No, it's not. That's a person of doubt and unbelief. Why? Because God's not gonna. He already has. Great faith is God has done this thing. By his stripes, I'm healed. Now, if you're coming, for instance, if you're coming to me to minister to you, your faith or unbelief does not matter to me. The fact that you come is all that counts to me, and I'm going to believe when I lay hands on you. Amen? So I'm not trying to get your faith up to where you can get it for yourself, because if that were true, and I don't mind if you do that, you don't need to come down here down front and get prayed for, because it was done the minute you believed. Does this make sense?
Yes, sir.
And see, okay, is there any wonder why I don't get invited to a lot of conferences with other ministers? Why? Because I expose all their fluff, all the stuff, right? And because it aggravates me when I see people misled willingly or, you know, on purpose or not on purpose by a person, especially if it's to keep them coming. I had the same thing back when I was teaching martial arts. They would add fluff and add a bunch of filler and all this kind of stuff into it. And it's like, no, just teach what the people need. Give them what they need, what they can use, and strip away everything else that is not necessary. Because I'm telling you, if it's in the Bible, it's necessary. If it's not in the Bible, it's not necessary.
Amen.
Whatever you need, God has provided in His Word.
That's right.
Amen? And so we don't need to add stuff. There's nothing in the Bible about fire tunnels. There's nothing in there about these fire tunnels and doing these kinds of... Now, and the amazing thing is, the things that God did, He really did apart from man. Okay, on the day of Pentecost, a rushing mighty wind came in. Do you think the 120 were sitting there praying for a rushing mighty wind? No, they had no idea what to expect. All they said was, we're supposed to sit here and wait.
Right?
Now, apparently they've been praying and whatever else is going on, but they didn't set it up. They didn't do anything. All they did was show up. Why? Because Jesus said, do this. He said, you wait. And then on the day of Pentecost, it was fully come, then the Holy Spirit showed up, filled them all. Isn't that right? And they all began to speak with their tongues. They didn't know anything about tongues. They didn't even know. Nobody, they had never heard anybody speak in tongues. They didn't know. There was no priming the pump with them. Amen? Can you imagine what it must have been like to be there in that room and then this thing happened? You know, the place is shaking, the wind's blowing in a room, which I'm pretty sure the doors and windows were closed because they were probably not feeling too safe, you know, by the local authorities. And so, and then all of a sudden this thing starts happening. And then all of a sudden these flames, you know, tongues of fire, as they say, sat upon each one of them. Can you imagine what they're like? Yep, still there. You know, it's just, well, you got it too. Can you imagine what they were thinking? What was happening? And then all of a sudden they start speaking all these other languages and they didn't know what each one of them was speaking and didn't know what was going on. And somehow they end up outside. And then all these other people that were there for the Feast of Pentecost started hearing what's going on, and they hear them speaking in their own language. And many times those people, local people like that, were not all that educated, and many of them didn't speak different languages. And here they're speaking languages from people that obviously weren't from that same place, and they didn't even know what they were telling those people, but those other people understood what they were saying, which means they were speaking human languages. Isn't that right? And so there's all this stuff that is kind of mixed in with the teaching on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And there's, you know, I'll be honest with you, I have questions. Now, I'm settled on certain things, and I'm satisfied with what I'm settled on. There's questions I have. And surprisingly, I've never been asked some of these questions I have, okay? But looking at these things, the bottom line is this. There is one purpose, one real purpose, one stated purpose for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And that's what Jesus said. He said, but you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost will come upon you. Now, that tells us two things. At that point, the Holy Ghost wouldn't come upon them. Isn't that right? So at that point, there was something, there was still an experience they had to receive. And he said, but when you receive this experience, when this thing happens, you shall receive dunamis, miraculous ability. Now, notice, we get hung up on the tongues. A lot of people do. You know, well, it's this, what is that? And then people ask me, well, you've said stuff about false tongues and different things, and how do I know if I got real tongues or false tongues? And I want to talk about some of that. We're not going to spend too much time on it, but I will talk about it in a future time. Most of this stuff is in the book that I did on concerning tongues, and it goes into a lot of these details. Now, but what we have to realize is this. We are dealing with God, first and foremost. And so God knows. He has the answers. We are dealing with a being who has power that is outside of the natural realm. And so we have to understand that he's going to do things sometimes in ways that doesn't match our experiences. And it's going to be outside of our experience. Now, when he said, when Jesus said, well, I want to read a couple of things to you because I want to give you some scripture. And I want to show you what goes on with this. Because the primary aspect, like I said, of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is for power. Power for you, now listen carefully, power for you to be a witness, not power for you to witness. Do you get that? Now, if you are a witness and the power of the Holy Spirit is in your life, then you will also have the power to witness. But he did not call us to witness. He called us to be witnesses in our life. Do you understand that? Yes. And so the baptism of the Holy Spirit was to empower us to be witnesses. Now, that word witness there, unfortunately, is the Greek word for martyr. And he said, so the Holy Spirit is going to give you the power to become a martyr. That's literally what it means. Now, that's a far cry from the, oh, I want the blessing, right? And so now we have to understand. Now, of course, there's two aspects of dying. There's dying to the flesh, and then there's spiritual death, right? And so you have the dying to self, and now I would even say there's physical death, of course. And so we have the dying to self, which the Holy Spirit also helps us to do. But then there's also becoming a martyr. You can be a martyr by dying to self. That's one aspect. But the Bible says that we have died and been raised with him. Is that right? So there is an aspect of death that we have already experienced. But then he also says, and we know from Scripture, what we do know is this. There is no recorded instance of any of the original apostles dying a peaceful death, with possibly the exception of the Apostle John. He's the only one. And we get all this from church tradition. There's really no history of it, but they talk about where they went, different places, how they died. Almost every one of them died violent deaths as martyrs because they witnessed and were witnesses in an area. Now, the Apostle John, they say they tried to boil him in oil and couldn't kill him. And so they exiled him to the Isle of Patmos, and I guess probably possibly because he still had to write the book of the Revelation of Jesus Christ, but he was there. And so there's no record of how he actually died. Now, there is church history that said even as he was dying, that or in very old age, that they would, when he would speak to the local congregation there, which was in a house, they would help him up. He was very old, and they said he would come to the front, and he would give a word. He wouldn't really preach, but he would get up and he'd say, "Little children, love one another." That's all he would say. And then they would lead him back, and he would sit down, and he would listen to somebody else share. Because back then, church wasn't one person talking. Back then, it was, well, life teams. You come together, you discuss, you pray, you speak, you do different things. Everybody has a psalm, has a hymn, has a teaching, different things. And so all of this is going on, but one of the key things about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, number one, is power. Power to witness, okay, to be a witness, we should say. And then number two, with that, often tongues are accompany that. Now, I'd say that is the divine order of things, is for when a person receives the baptism of the Spirit, that they speak in other tongues. Now, we have more record of that in the book of Acts than we do of them not doing that, okay? So that could be a pattern there. Now, but we should not use tongues, and this is one of the key things, because even in most statements of faith, they will say that they, especially charismatic churches, Pentecostal churches, that they believe that tongues, speaking in other tongues, is the initial evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, there's nothing in the Bible that says that it is the initial evidence. That term is not in Bible, okay? It is in theology. It is in denominational terminology. But it is not Bible in the sense that the Bible doesn't, it never uses that tongues as initial evidence. Now, I don't have any problem with the idea of it. Some people, and matter of fact, that very clause or point is what caused F.F. Bosworth to break away from the Assemblies of God. And because they, in 1914, they formed, in 1916, They said, okay, tongues, the initial evidence. 1918, they were coming back and saying, yeah, we're going to enforce that, and we're going to start really abiding by that. And he said, I can't do that. He said, I believe that any manifestation of the Spirit should be evidence of the baptism of the Spirit. And he talked about different gifts and different things. And so he left the Assemblies of God and went and joined the Christian and Missionary Alliance, CMA. And so he joined and stayed with them pretty much for the rest of his life. Retired and then came out of retirement and traveled with William Branham for a while. So anyway, then, but his big deal was I cannot say that the initial evidence of speaking in other tongues, that's the initial evidence of the baptism of the Spirit. He said, I agree with it. I believe that you should speak in other tongues. I believe that you generally will, but making it a rule. Now, the problem with that is this. Being raised up in certain circles, E.W. Kenyon was one of the big influences of his material. I read all his material, and T.L. Osborne said that E.W. Kenyon was his Bible school, that's where he got a lot of his training. And then, of course, he went and was trained personally under F.F. Bosworth. So those two areas intersected. E.W. Kenyon said that we should never need a physical evidence for a spiritual truth. Okay, and that's a big deal. Because if you go with tongues being the initial evidence, now you're saying you have that God gave man a physical proof of a spiritual truth. Okay, which again, I can see God doing some things like that, and I don't have any problem with it. But the big deal is that you don't have to rely on it. However, many people look at tongues, in other words, until they have spoken in tongues, they don't believe they've received the baptism in the Spirit. The baptism of the Spirit is primarily for power to be a witness. So as far as I'm concerned, now the Bible is clear what happened, Acts chapter 1, Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 3. As we said before, the promise, the power, and the proof. In Acts chapter 1, there's a promise, and he said that the promise is the promise of the Father. And he said, wait until you receive it. Then in Acts chapter 2, they receive the power. Then in Acts chapter 3, we see the proof of the power when the Apostle Peter raised up the lame man, right? And so we have those three. Now, most of the proofs in the book of Acts that we have concerning the power of the Holy Spirit mostly was operating through apostles. That's what gave rise to the idea that only the apostles had power. But that's not true, because we see others. We see Philip. We see different people that were not apostles, and Stephen, people like that did miracles, basically, and yet they were not apostles. So we know that the power of the Holy Spirit was not just a power amongst the 12 or the 11, however you want to say it. So the reason I'm saying this is because I want you to understand that the baptism of the Holy Spirit, while it is a theological doctrine, it is also a spiritual reality, and it is a biblical truth. Amen? And so the problem is many times we get hung up on the, as we used to say all the time, we get hung up on the gift and not the giver. Or we get hung up on the blessing and not the blesser. And so I want to emphasize that if you are seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit, first off, you are seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Right? Now, God makes you holy inside when you get born again, and you're recreated in his image, holy. Now, but that holiness inside should start to be seen on the outside at some point. Now, they say, and I would tend to agree with this, that the first thing that changes when you get born again is your mouth. Right? And you can see that, part of it, you can see it from the 1904 Welsh Revival. In Wales, they had this great revival among the coal miners, and you may have heard me talk about this before, but these coal miners were pretty foul-mouthed. And then when this revival happened, they got saved, and they quit cussing. Just instantly, just quit cussing. And none of the mules would obey them because the mules were used to being cussed at, and so they didn't understand the commands anymore. So they had to retrain the mules to operate without cussing. I don't know how many times mules are going to come up today. But listen, we may need to be like those mules and be retrained Okay? Because the Bible says that with our tongues, we can turn our entire body. Isn't that right? And so there is an aspect. Now, I'm not saying, you know, if you, we were talking the other day and somebody made a statement and they said, you know, I love Jesus, but I cuss a little. Okay, I've seen the sign before, and that's cute, okay? Most cussing has to do with some type of degeneration, something, all right? It's downward talk. And it's amazing as we get around. If you go to the bookstores right now, probably the number one book, we were in a bookstore just the other day, my wife and I, up in Sherman. And right there on an end cap is a whole section of books that are business books and self-help books and all this kind of stuff, all in this section, and they all start with the F word. And had it on the book. It's there, right? And I don't know. I'm getting older, I guess. And I recognize when I was younger and how much things have changed. Uh-huh. And I'm thinking, okay, if this is, number one, if that's on the front, used to, that wasn't on the front cover of any book. Used to, that wasn't even in books, uh-huh. right? And now it's on the front cover and they're using it. Because why? They're thumbing themselves at God. And now degeneration has happened to where some preachers either cuss or come so close to cussing in the pulpit because they're trying to be relevant. Well, just because you're relevant to people, you sometimes making yourself quote unquote relevant to people can make you irrelevant to God. And so if we are going to receive the Holy Spirit, first and foremost, our lives should be holy. Now that does not mean that you have to take off your jewelry or, you know, not wear makeup or wear your dresses to here and to there. I'm not talking about that. Isn't it funny we all talk about that and it's automatically dresses and not men? Yeah. Anyway. So, I'm not talking about that necessarily, but I'm saying your life, there should be a holiness in your life. There should be a goodness. There should be a cleanness. See, there's a reason the Bible talks about an unclean spirit, always in a negative connotation. You never get an unclean spirit from God. Why? Because he cleans you up. See, with God, it's cleansing, right? It is not the degeneration. And with God, your mouth will clean up. Right? With God, your life will clean up. Why? Because you have the Holy Spirit. Yes. Not an unholy spirit, but a Holy Spirit. Not the spirit of the world, so you fit in with the world. But you have the Holy Spirit that makes you separate, makes you that light that draws people. Amen? So all of this has to do with the Holy Spirit. Now the problem is we get, just like we're talking with these fire tunnels and all these different kind of things, You don't see, most of these things are just for services, to make a good service, to get people excited, to get them whipped into a frenzy of something. And see, real Christianity is, as John Lake used to say, it's not a puffing up, but a settling down. It's a digging down into the thing. See, there's things that, And my daughter, and I've talked to my daughter about this before, and she brought up a really good point in it. And she said, you know, we always heard growing up in churches we'd go to, especially with youth group, oh, if you give this up for God, he'll give you something better. And she said, you know, sometimes you need to give up things without thinking of getting anything back. Right. Some things you don't need replaced. Some things you just need to get out of your life. Yeah. Yeah. Amen? Right. But see, we have this idea. Now, and I was talking with George the other day. I talk with him almost every day, every other day anyway. And we were talking about this thing. Now, here's the problem. What we're seeing in the world is that, okay, the Bible says that in the end times, how many of you know we're in the end times? Okay. In the end times, and he even said in the latter days. Now, when Paul said that, he knew he was in the end times. Because he knew that Peter said, this is that in the last days. So that was all after that. So Paul knew he was in the end times. But even he said, in the latter days, in the latter times. Isn't that right? He said, this is what's going to happen. There's going to be a falling away. And as a matter of fact, Othniel mentioned it today. and about how people's, because of the increase of iniquity, people's love will start to wax cold. Isn't it right? Well, their love for who? For God and for man. And so here's the thing. What we've noticed, and you know, God is, he is a master chess player, you know? But Satan also plays chess. He's not as good. He's pretty good, you know? Not as good as God at it, obviously, but he is better at it than most humans because he plans way ahead and he tries to set things up ahead of time. Now, what he has done in the church over the last 10, 15 years, predominantly, it's a little bit before that, and it went around a long time before that, was he brought in this, the false grace message, which says nothing matters anymore, sin doesn't matter, God is only good in the sense that he'll only bless you, he doesn't hold you responsible for anything, nothing to be remembered, none of that stuff. See, that's what they have started saying. And that is the common idea of grace in the church today. And because of that, people have no idea of any remorse. And if you don't have remorse, you don't have a sense of repentance. And so now you have salvation without repentance, so-called. I'm not saying it's true salvation. I'm saying people think they can get it that way. And so you have all this going on. Now, the problem is this. You're going to have, in the near future, we're already seeing it. The thing is, I hate to get you to understand this, I might have to say something that I really wouldn't plan on bringing in. But hopefully you'll get it. I'm going to do it anyway, so hopefully bear with me, all right, for just a minute or two. When you look at certain countries, predominantly UK, Great Britain, England, Canada, and Australia. Now, obviously, they're all linked and related, and then you have America. And America, even though the British and the English peoples, you might say, are related to us, we made a very big difference whenever we broke away from their rule, right? Whatever we used to do, we did the opposite, you know? Instead of driving on the left-hand side, now we drive on the right-hand side. I mean, probably just to be contrary, more than likely, I mean, you know, it's just, well, this is how they did it. That's not how we're going to do it. We're going to do it this way. Well, you know, whatever. But now, if you will notice, for some reason, America has had this, I don't know, this thing about Europe, that they want to be like Europe. Okay, I've been to Europe. You don't want to be like Europe. Okay, God bless Europeans. Europe needs help. Okay, it's messed up. We've been there. And I've been places, and honestly, I've just shocked at some of the stuff that is ridiculous. So, but for some reason, we keep getting Europe kind of shoved down our throats. Be like Europe, be like Europe, do this, do what they did. And then all this other stuff happened, and now 2020, the world's a different place, and you know nobody wants to be like anybody anymore for the most part. Well, here's the problem. America is the only country now, especially, that is still armed. The civilians are armed, pretty much. Now, I'm talking about legally armed, right? It's funny, because all countries, many of the citizens are still illegally armed. Right. But America is the only place where they were really legally armed, for the most part. And, you know, people could say, well, if you're in Canada, you can do this. And okay, but the restrictions are such that most people just don't even try, because it's too hard to live within the restrictions. But both people of the UK, of Canada, and Australia have given up any right of defense, personal defense, self-defense, that kind of stuff. They've given it up. And they have been disarmed. And historically, you're a civilian or a citizen as long as you're armed. As soon as you're not armed, you're no longer a civilian or a citizen. Now you are a subject. Yeah. And things are dictated. Now, I talk to people in Canada, I talk to people in Australia, some even in UK, and the thing is, now it is even illegal to defend yourself in any way. Therefore, you must rely on government officials to do that. Hopefully, they're not corrupt. Hopefully, they care enough to defend you, right? But now this goes back to the very base of this started when we started giving up our, how can I say it? We gave up our responsibility to raise our own children. And we give the education of our children to a person we don't even really know, and to a system that is geared in a certain way that does not work in our benefit or our children's benefit. And so we give up that right. And now, if you don't take them there, now you can actually be charged, and all of a sudden now it's wrong, right? Even though now the homeschooling thing has come to a good place in this sense. And it's funny because when all this stuff happened, all of a sudden homeschooling's okay. Yeah. Isn't that something? Anyway, till then, you'd go to jail if you didn't send your kids to school enough days out of the year. So we gave up our right to do that. And then you give up different rights, okay? For the most part, different people, but they even give up the right of and the responsibility of their own health to a doctor. But whatever he says, why? Well, because, he's God. God in a white coat. No, he's not. He's a man, and he's practicing medicine on you. And it's funny, you tell him what you're going through, whatever it is, and what is it? He Googles it. Well, you can Google it for a lot cheaper than getting him to Google it.
Right?
I'm not against doctors, right? They found a great way to make money easy off of people. I don't know. Anyway, I'm just kidding. Well, kind of kidding. Anyway. Now we also have got to a place in many countries where we have given up the responsibility to defend ourselves and our homes and our families and loved ones and the innocent and the weak. We've given it over to another person that we have to call them to come to us and hope they get to us in time. Because the laws where we have disarmed ourselves, for the most part, didn't stop home invasions. You can look at Australia. You can look at different places. It hadn't stopped the crime. And so now, and if you go back, and it's kind of funny because some of these things go back to looking at some of the details and the rates of these things. Now, you say, what has this got to do with the baptism of the Holy Spirit? This is the point. In Christianity, we have given over our responsibility, in many cases, to whoever's behind the pulpit. Rather than thinking for ourselves, rather than reading for the Bible, because the other aspect, remember when I said there are several aspects, benefits of having the Holy Spirit baptism. One of those is that we receive power. But the other is that we receive a teacher who will lead and guide us into all truth. Now see, my job is to allow him to work through me so that I help you move into all truth. But he's your teacher, and he's the one responsible for taking you into all truth. Amen? And so you when you come in here, you don't lay your responsibility down out there and go, well, whatever Brother Curry says, I'm just gonna believe it because he said it. I'm not gonna check it out. I'm not gonna read it for myself. No, I do everything in my power to make sure you don't do that. Why? Because I'm supposed to be raising up individual believers that if whatever the enemy is that you may see coming, if he puts his foot down to try to stomp out this flame, instead he just scatters us.
Right.
Instead of putting us out.
Right. Out.
Amen? And so that's the key. Now, here's the thing, that because of the wrong grace message, people have gotten to the place in church, and I got letters this week, which is, I normally get a letter once a month. I get letters every day, but I'm saying this kind of letter I usually get once a month. But here lately, I've been getting them two and maybe even three a week, which says that there's a shift. There's something going on in the church world because I notice patterns, and I can see this pattern growing, and the pattern is this. I'm getting more and more letters from people. I don't know why they contact me, as I've said before, but they write me and tell me how mad they are at God, right? I mean, I guess they think I'm just so close to him that, if they tell me, it'll get to his ear. You really upset this person. I'm just telling you, they're really upset at you. I don't know. But they write me, and they don't just write a paragraph or a sentence. I mean, it's a letter about why they're mad at God and why, they might as well just kill themselves and why they made it, why? Because God's word isn't true, because he said he healed everybody and they're not healed, and the people they prayed for maybe didn't get healed. I mean, I'm combining a bunch of different letters and information in them. But I've noticed this, that there's a different type of Christianity now, for the most part. And the type of Christianity we have today is, I'm not even going to call it bold. It's not bold. It's rude. It's brash. It's foolish. Because people say things about God in a letter to me that if I had thought it, you know, 30 years ago, I would have quickly did something to, you know, God, I wasn't thinking that. I wasn't thinking that. That's not what was on my mind. Why? Because I reverenced him, right? Because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So when you have no fear of God, when you have no idea, when you just rail against God, then you're not anywhere near the beginning of wisdom. You're at the other end of the spectrum, at the tail end of idiocy. Because it is stupid to be mad at God. Amen? Because somewhere, because God ain't wrong. He ain't never been wrong. He's never going to be wrong. And so if he said something, you're not experiencing it, the failure is in you. Now, the failure could be you were taught that by somebody. I'm not saying that the failure is your fault necessarily. I'm saying that for whatever reason, the failure ends in you, and you're going to have to find out what that failure is. I guarantee you this, you're not going to find out nothing railing at God, because he ain't even talking to you other than going, shut your mouth and start listening. That's pretty much what he's going to end up saying to you. If he says that, right? Because if you have had any contact with God, you have to remember, God is God.
Right.
Okay? That's number one. Number two, you're not. Right? You're not God. That's the second thing to remember. Right? And so we are here at his goodness. Amen?
Yes.
And so people don't have a respect for God, especially now. So what's happening is this. Now we have a motivational Christianity. We have, maybe it's inspirational, but it's definitely not theologically correct or biblically correct. But we have this, we have promoted the idea that God is, you know, most preachers are simply television, where they have those infomercials, kind of like that. You ever seen the info cooking commercials? Where they have the pans that they're using and that they're trying to sell you this thing, and they're doing all this stuff and they're talking about it and they're over the top excited and it's great, and you know, and then they say, hey, try this, and a person tries it before they even get it in their mouth. Oh, that's great. And hadn't even had time to hit their palate yet, but they're already smiling and, oh, this is wonderful. And it becomes just a sales thing, and we've presented God as though he somehow needs us, and he needs you for him to be God. And that's not, okay, God will exist even if we didn't. Do you get that? And so many times, though, we have taken, because it's a good sales tactic. It's a good sales tactic to promise people all the added, what is it, the value-added benefits of sales of God. Come to God. Oh, he'll bless you. He'll heal you. He'll make you wealthy. He'll make you healthy. And you sound like the snake oil salesman that you used to see in all the TV shows, the guy that rides in on a wagon and, you know, sells the potion of Dr. So-and-so and all that kind of stuff. And it's kind of become that way again, to where we're just selling stuff to people. And the idea of what you're selling, you're selling God. And you're saying, if you come to God, he'll do this. If you come to this, he'll do that. And we may. Now, is there truth to the blessings of God? Absolutely. Does he want you blessed more than he wants you cursed? Absolutely. That's why he tells you, blessing and cursing, life and death, choose life. That's why he said it. But when we get to the point where we don't love him, but we love his stuff,
right,
then we're nothing but prostitutes. Does that make sense?
Sure.
When we get to the point where, you know, I don't want to hang out with God. I don't want to talk with God, but I want his blessing. And I want his stuff. And when he gives me his stuff, now it's my stuff, and I don't even have to be thankful to him for what he gave me. Am I making sense? That we've gotten to a point. Now, the bad part of this is this. Because of the grace message, the wrong grace method, the untrue, right? Hyper grace is, I think, what somebody calls it. Grace beyond which what God meant for it to be. Because of that, when people are promised these blessings and they don't see them, then there is an automatic tendency to fall away.
Yep.
Turn your back on God and what? You didn't give me what you promised, so there. I don't want nothing to do with you. Because of that, I firmly believe that that is what is going to usher in the many departing from the faith. And we're starting to see it. See, the false grace, see, that works for a while because people keep hoping it'll work out. And at some point, they realize it's not. And then they go, oh, well, I might as well go back to doing whatever I was doing, because that's not true. And the thing is, you can't tell. The bad part is the devil has played chess by setting this thing up, banking on the fact of promising you everything and knowing you wouldn't get it, and knowing when you didn't get it, you would blame it on God when it wasn't God that promised it. It was the devil promising it through false teaching.
Wow.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now, we've been talking some about this for years and years, and you know, I like good, you know, motivational stuff. I want something that motivates me more than I want something that doesn't motivate me, right? I'd rather be motivated than demotivated, okay? I've gone to some churches where I was demotivated, right? And then I've been to some churches where I come out feeling good, but I could have went to, you know, a Tony Robbins seminar, which I've never been to a Tony Robbins seminar, but I've watched some of his stuff on internet and that kind of stuff. And it's amazing because of how he operates. There is a deception there. And it's very sneaky, right? And I'm not saying he's trying to be sneaky. He may actually believe what he's saying. But basically what they did, that whole group, Oprah and Tony Robbins and, boy, I almost said a preacher's name. Anyway, what they've done is they have talked about all the goodness of God without bringing God in. And it's a new age religion. And it's moving that direction. And the amazing thing is because isn't it funny that a couple of years ago, the big, remember the big thing, there was a politician that said, oh, these are, I should have wrote the words down, these are bitter religious people hanging on to their God and their guns. Remember that kind of I know I just butchered the phrase, but it's basically what I said. But it's amazing how all of this goes back to Christians. And a lot of the things that you're going to be seeing is going to have, it's already started in many of these cases. And the first thing, like we said in Canada and Australia, places like that, was they disarm, because then they can impose whatever they want. And now we're starting to see even things about, you know, the COVID vaccination, that kind of stuff, how they're going to be mandatory and different things. And they've already passed some things in Canada, making it mandatory. And the way they do it is they say, well, we're not saying you have to do this, but if you're going to ride on this plane, and they're going to talk about a certificate, that you have a card, a vaccination card, to prove you have received the vaccination. And so they're not making you do it. They're just telling you you can't do these things if you don't do it. And so people will give in. Now, the question is this. You have to know what's in that stuff. And if you don't know what's in the vaccination, it can damage, right? And not just that one, but many others. But the bottom line is this. It is amazing to me about the fear level from a disease, so-called, that has a 99.7% survival rate. And that many of the people that catch it are asymptomatic and don't even have any proof of it. And yet, it is so dangerous that we have to have a mandated vaccination, that we have to have a mandated this or that type of thing. And I'm telling you, what is happening is that, first off, the mask thing, because that's already been proven it doesn't work. It's already been proven. But there is a conditioning process that goes to you listening to this and listening to that and doing these things. And at some point, your decision may actually impact your life and what you do with it. Now, me, I have both what I would consider common sense decisions, but I also have spiritual decisions, which also make common sense. But there is a point at which basically I say, okay, this is it. Not going any further. And I'm done. And in those situations, it's kind of like, look, many years ago, I gave my life to Christ. He is my Lord. He saved me. His Father is my Father. And the Bible tells me how I should live. When I went into the military, I took an oath. And in that oath, I said that I would defend the U.S. Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic. And there was never a point where I was released from that oath. Lastly, well, even before I went in that, when I went into martial arts, there was a school pledge that we said, like a motto, and it was to get it into it. And part of that is that everything I learned, I would never use aggressively, maliciously, but that I would defend the weak, the innocent, and those unable to defend themselves. And I have never disavowed that oath either. And so there is a lot of balancing that I'm looking at right now and saying, where do we stand? Where do I stand? And I'm wanting to make sure that I'm not putting my stand on you and telling you you have to take the same stand that I do. Many times the stand comes out in how we're saying things. That's why I wanted to teach on the baptism of the Holy Spirit today, because without the Holy Spirit leading and guiding, then it'll be very easy to become mentally oriented. And when you become mentally oriented, sometimes what seems to be logical can lead you in a circle to what is unethical. And so, you know, going back to the, remember back in the 60s and all that, and 70s, 80s, remember my body, remember the women, remember the big thing, this is my body, I can do with my body what I want to, and they were talking about abortion. And now you got one side of American citizenry that want to endorse that 100%. Your body, you do whatever you want with your body. And if you want to get an abortion, you can do it. You can do anything with your body you want to do, and we cannot stop you. Well, it may be time that we jump on that bandwagon. My body. Nothing comes into this body that I don't want there. And so I will make that same stand as somebody, you know. I remember back in the 80s and the women, they were burning their bras. I don't know what stand we're, I don't know how we're going to demonstrate our stand. Okay. Burn the mask. Burn the mask. There, perfect. There we go. Maybe we need to have some mask burnings. Amen. So, that's good. I like that. Y'all stay tuned this week for our post. it won't be in here, but it might be outside. But all I'm saying is that we're at a point where every person is going to have to make that decision for their life. And one of the main things is that if we are separated, it's easy for the enemy to pick us off. But united we stand. Amen. And with God behind us, based on, I firmly believe that America was birthed from a God-given plan. And because of that, it is in our very formation documents that we have certain inalienable rights granted to us by God, not by government. And because of that, then we can look to God and he will lead us and guide us, protect us, and we can see the miraculous happen.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
But now, if you desire, and I should emphasize, being baptized in the Holy Spirit. If you want to be baptized, okay. I've heard people say one baptism, many fillings. Okay, kind of. But if you want the baptism, then you got to stay baptized, right? And you can be filled. And Ephesians tells us, be filled with the Spirit. Speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. The original Greek says, be being filled. It's a constant state of being filled with the Spirit. And that constant state should be the point where he is constantly leading, guiding, teaching. He can tell you where to go, where not to go, who to do business with, who not to do business. I mean, he wants to have input in every aspect of your life. And now more than ever, if we're going to walk in the Spirit, then we're going to have to be conscious of him and give him leeway and actually bow our knee to him and say, what do you want me to do? Where am I at? What do you want me to do? And then follow that leading because he is speaking. Amen? Now, I know this isn't some rah-rah pep rally type thing, but regardless, hopefully I've given you something to think about today, because the baptism with the Holy Spirit, as we said before, salvation is the greatest gift God has ever given the world. The baptism in the Holy Spirit is the greatest gift God ever gave the church.
Amen.
And it is something we need to recognize and depend upon. Because we're not in this on our own. He is with us.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
As long as we walk righteously. Now, I know I got to stop. I'm going on. Other questions people have asked me have to do with like self-defense and that kind of stuff. And because they say, you know, you're to turn the other cheek and not retaliate and not render evil for evil. And I agree 100%. And I will turn my cheek because it's my choice. But I do it not out of fear because I know I don't have to. You understand? I don't have to. At the same time, I also know that I would defend a person whose cheek is being turned because I can also help that person. And so the difference is this. Defense is not retaliation. See, defense is me stopping you from doing something to me or someone else, my loved one or even somebody I don't know. That's defense. Because you're attacking, I defend. Retaliation would be, after I have defended, then I hunt your family down and I do something to them. That's retaliation. Defense is not retaliation. Defense is the ability to protect. The motto of police departments is to protect and to serve. It should be the motto of every Christian. Now, how far you go with that is up to you. But you have to realize that who could be most trusted to do the right thing more than a Christian? Because a Christian should be able to do something to stop a situation, knowing that they will stop as soon as they can and not go overboard. Does that make sense? So in this, we have to realize that as Christians, we have the responsibility to live in grace and treat people with grace. At the same time, the Bible says that we have entered grace. We have access to grace through faith. So if you do not have faith in Christ Jesus, you are not in grace. You are still under law. Because there's law and there's grace. Does that make sense? So there's law and there's grace. And we have access to grace through faith. But people who do not have faith do not have access to grace. Now, I have the ability to give grace even if they're not in grace. But if they're under law and acting under law, meaning I'm talking about doing wrong, then under law, it's eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. That's the law of God. Do you get that? So in that, we have to decide where we walk. And the beauty is, because if you don't believe that, then you don't believe that a Christian should ever be a policeman or be in the military. Because part of their job is enforcing law, not enforcing grace. But even police give grace when they pull you over and don't give you a ticket. That's called grace. Amen? Do you see that? God is a spirit. We live in a natural world. He is not foolish. He knows that his connection with man is on a physical level for natural man. And he has set up governments to do what is righteous so the people live in peace. And if the people are not living in peace, it's because the government is not righteous. And our Constitution gives us the right to change that. Amen?
Amen.
Maybe I'm giving you something to think about. All right. God bless you.